previously on the High Risk Wrestling Podcast. Champion, former TNT champion, Scorpio Sky can be the future for sure. So we're back from a break, right? And we got Toni Nese, smart Mark Sterling in the ring. And Nese does his heel gimmick, you know, because he's the premier athlete. He's everybody's fat. He's going to work out. And that's what we're going to do until the Redeemer, Miro, finally returns. And you knew how this was going to go. Nese got some. Good afternoon, good morning, good evening, everybody. It is Saturday, June 24th, and you know what that means. It is time for the High Risk Wrestling Podcast. I am your host. Welcome to the charismatic penitentiary. That's just corny. I know, but we're here, we're back. As always, you know you can check out the socials, Charismatic Creations on Facebook and YouTube, Charismatic underscore Creations 52 on Instagram, the 215 on Twitter. And as always, coffee and Patreon for all donations. Yes, they are welcomed and appreciated. And this is the start of quote unquote a new era, y'all, for the High Risk Wrestling channel and Charismatic Creations. So one more time, go over the changes quickly. So the High Risk Wrestling Podcast, which you're listening to or watching, will be changing. So once again, we won't be covering the news, we won't be covering the weekend review weekly shows. What we have for the podcast now from here will be a list pertaining to the show's topic for today, a wrestler spotlight pertaining to the show's topic, and then the show topic. Whereas the High Risk Wrestling Recap, which will be launching on the 25th, will be the news, the show recaps of Raw, Dynamite, Impact, Ring of Honor, SmackDown, and Collision, the matches of the week, and ending with the star of the week. So I'm ready for this. I'm ready for this change. We're going to get to get and we're going to make it happen. But look, you know what's next, so just go on and hit my music. All right, seeing as how we're talking about Forbidden Door today, and we're starting this new era. This is the first list that, you know, on the show, and it's a good way for me to get more lists going. It's the easy way to get good content and to spark discussion. So what I have for you are the five best matches from last year's Forbidden Door. All right. So first things first, honorable mention goes to Thunder Rosa versus Toni Storm, with Thunder Rosa defending the AEW Women's World Championship. That was a very, very fun, hard hitting match. I am really, really, really enjoying Toni Storm's matches in AEW, especially when she's going against someone that can throw her around, have a little bit of power with her. So her matches with Thunder Rosa, her matches with Jamie Hayter are really, really fun. This was definitely a heated rivalry, and Thunder Rosa retained. She won the Final Reckoning because Toni Storm kicked out of the Fire Thunder Driver, which was really, really, really good. So this gets honorable mention. But number five on the list will be Jay White defending the IWGP World Heavyweight Championship against Hangman Page, Adam Cole, and Kazuchika Okada. Now, it's funny that we're just a year away from this, and you go back and look at the card and see just where everybody changed from a year ago. But this was a solid match marred by an unfortunate ending. This was the match where Adam Cole suffered that really, really bad concussion, and it just, man, kept him out. But you have four of the biggest stars in pro wrestling right now at that point, and it was just, it was a fun, solid match. Everybody got to really show what they were made of, and it's the first time, you know, a lot of audience got to see Okada. It was a genuinely great match. It's just that ending just sucked, and it really showed American fans that that don't watch New Japan, that don't watch Impact, just who Jay White truly is. So number four, John Moxley versus Hiroshi Tanahashi for the interim AEW World Championship. Now y'all know me, y'all know what I wanted. I wanted Tanahashi to win this match. I just thought it would have been great. Tanahashi wins, John Moxley doesn't suffer from this, and you can have Tanahashi defend the championship against CM Punk, therefore getting the belt back on Punk, which is what you originally wanted. But this was a really fine, serviceable match. These dudes put in work. I mean, Tanahashi is the ace, ladies and gentlemen. He is the ace. And this was really to set up the blood and guts, because there was some after match shenanigans, but I really would have enjoyed Punk versus Tanahashi afterwards. Number three, Pac versus Miro versus Clark Connors versus Malakai Black to crown the inaugural AEW All Atlantic Champion, now the International Championship. This was fast. This was boom, 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 boom. Go, 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 go. And you would think, well, the odd man out was to be Clark Connors, because who is Clark Connors? He's not Malakai Black. He's not Pac. He's not Miro. These are named people. But Clark Connors put in the work, and he showed that he belonged. He really, really shined and got over with the crowd, because many of us expected Ishii to be in this spot, but he wasn't. Miro once again looked dominant, and I was really pulling for Miro to win this match, but in the end, Pac won, becoming the first ever All Atlantic champion. Number two, Claudio Castagnoli versus Zack Sabre Jr. Now, this match was originally supposed to be Zack Sabre Jr. versus Bryan Danielson, because you know every match with Bryan Danielson is a dream match at this point. And this is one of those dream match matches. You know what I mean? But Claudio was a very, very good replacement. He and Zack Sabre Jr. put on just a nice wrestling tennis match of technical masterpiece and just straight up strength and brute force, and it was just really, really beautiful. It was a really beautiful match. Claudio got the win, setting him up to join the BCC. Very, very underrated match. Very, very, very underrated person in Claudio, and we know what number one is. This match stole the show. Orange Cassidy taking on Will Ospreay, who was defending his United States Heavyweight Championship. And ladies and gentlemen, I remember people were like, well, why is this match happening? It's Orange Cassidy. Will Ospreay too serious? No. Will Ospreay can be funny. It's like this was so perfect. This was such an amazing match. Like if you weren't sold on Orange Cassidy, this match right here had to sell you on Orange Cassidy, because that's how great he was. We know Will Ospreay, and we've seen time again Orange Cassidy put on great matches, but I would like to point to this right here was the start of this run that Orange Cassidy's been on, because not soon here thereafter he defeated Pac about 2-3 months later for the International Championship. And you can really point everything back to this. Plus, this match also brought back Shibata. He showed up and helped Orange Cassidy, and these two have had a really fun friendship. But those are the five best matches from AEW Cross New Japan Forbidden Door 2022. So our superstar spotlight for this show, there are a lot of people we could look at, but I'm going to go with the man named after the piece of fruit, Orange Cassidy. He had the best match at last year's Forbidden Door, and he's on the card once again. And yes, he will probably be overshadowed. Can't steal the show every week. I mean, you figure with our main event, the U.S. title match, Punk, Toni, and Willow, this 10-man tag, Orange Cassidy could essentially be overshadowed, but I know he's going to be great. First of all, I recently discovered that Orange Cassidy's 38 years old. Never knew. Dude looks like he's in his 20s. But he is an interesting talent. And yes, I get that he might not be for everyone, but I feel like he's more for everyone than not. The dude is just legitimately good. And the run he's been on with the International Championship has been nothing short of astounding. It's been elevated above the TNT Championship. I would even say it's on par currently with the AEW World Championship, just because of the kind of just run Orange Cassidy's been on. Great, great matches. You think he's going to lose, because now we're telling that story where he's hurt. Now he's defended the championship. He already has the most title defenses in AEW history, and the wear and tear is getting to him. Looking at the card for tomorrow, he's defending his championship against Daniel Garcia, a great wrestler in his own right, Zack Sabre Jr., an even greater wrestler in his own right, and the legendary Katsuyori Shibata. So there are some expectations for this match, and Orange Cassidy is this guy I want to have here in this position. His comedy will help keep it lighthearted, but when the going gets tough, he will be ready. I expect Orange Cassidy to put on a great, great performance just like he did last year. But if you want to know who's going to win the match, you got to stay in for the predictions. But that's our superstar spotlight, Orange Cassidy, defending his international championship at Forbidden Door. Well, the Dream pay-per-view is back once again. AEW Cross New Japan Pro Wrestling presents Forbidden Door. And we do have another crossover show. New Japan does one with Impact Wrestling called Multiverse United. The next one is in Philadelphia. I will be there. I'm very, very excited. But to the Forbidden Door. Last year's show... last year's show was a fever dream. And we're here thinking, you know, when it got announced, wait, they're really doing this? And there were some setbacks. Last year's show was really, really hampered by injuries. But they still were able to pull it off. And this year's show is, it's headlined. Do I even want to call it a dream match? What's beyond a dream match? Where the ceiling of this match is possibly the greatest wrestling match of all time. And the floor is something like 4.5 stars. Our expectations are high. So we have Forbidden Door 2023, and let's take a look at last year's card. Let's take a look at last year's card and see just how big of a difference we have. So last year we had 13 matches, with four being on the pre-show. So on the pre-show, we had Bishimon, which is Haruka Goda and Yoshihashi defeating The Factory, Aaron Solo, QT Marshall. Lance Archer defeated Nick Camarado. Swerve in Our Glory, wow. Swerve in Our Glory defeated Suzuki Gun, El Desperado, and Yoshinobu Kanemaru. And Max Caster and the Gun Club defeated Yuya Yamura and the New Japan LA JoJo team of Alex Coughlin, the DKC, and Kevin Knight. And let's look at that last match right there. Just look how everybody's growing. Anthony Bowens was injured at that point, but Max Caster has, and the Acclaimed have grown up. Billy Gunn has split from his sons. He's now with the Acclaimed. Yuya Yamura is now a mainstay in Impact Wrestling, and Kevin Knight started to make his way over there. Like, that was just the pre-show. And on the main show, we opened up with Minoru Suzuki and the Sex Gods, Chris Jericho, Sammy Guevara, who are also, these three are teaming up again this year. They took on the team of Eddie Kingston, Shota Umino, and Wheeler Yuta. And guess what? This year's card, Eddie is on the opposite side now, taking on Umino and Wheeler Yuta. The Sex Gods won that match. We had a winner-take-all triple threat tag team match for the Ring of Honor World Tag Team Championships and the IWGP Tag Team Championships. FTR were the Ring of Honor Tag Team Champions, taking on the United Empire team of Great O'Khan and Jeff Cobb, who were the IWGP Tag Team Championships, and Roppongi Vice, New Japan mainstays, now part of Impact Wrestling, a team of Rocky Romero and Trent Beretta, and FTR won that. That's how they became 7-star FTR. They won the IWGP Tag Team Championship. They then won the World Tag Team Championships, which is very, very solid. Then we had the inaugural match for the inaugural All-Atlantic Championship with Pac defeating Clark Connors, Miro, and Malakai Black. Next up, we had the Dudes with Attitude, Darby Allin, Sting, and Shingo Takagi. And, I mean, the Dudes with Attitude name is just great, excuse me, taking on the Bullet Club team of El Phantasmo, Matt, and Nick Jackson, who had Hukuleo with them. The Dudes with Attitude won because Sting is undefeated in AEW. Thunder Rosa defended the Women's World Championship against Toni Storm, retaining the championship. Will Ospreay defended the IWGP United States Heavyweight Championship against Orange Cassidy. He was accompanied with, Will Ospreay himself was accompanied to the ring by Aussie Open. Ospreay won that match. Claudio Castagnoli made his AEW debut and defeated Zack Sabre Jr. Jay White, the IWGP Heavyweight Champion at the time with Guido, defeated Hangman Page, Kazuchika Okada, and Adam Cole, retaining the IWGP World Heavyweight Championship. In the main event, Jon Moxley, who was accompanied by William Regal, defeated Hiroshi Tanahashi to become the interim AEW World Champion. Yeah, that was a fun card, and there wasn't really a bad match on the card. There were some bangers, and we know what the banger was, but let's get into this year's show, Selby. So right now we only have one match on the pre-show schedule, and that is Athena taking on Billie Starkz, the young little wrestling prodigy, and a first round match in the Owen Hart Cup. Now, unless they plan on giving Billie a major run, we know she's not winning. What I'm expecting here, actually, is I'm expecting Athena to not dominate, but to guide Billie along, make her look good, and still win the match. Seeing as how this is the only match on the pre-show, I expect us to go maybe 10 minutes because we have 10 matches on the main card. And we know this is going to be a long show. So, but I expect Athena to win to move on to the second round of the women's brackets, that side of the Owen Hart Cup. And I believe she will face the winner of Britt Baker and Ruby Soho. Yes, she faces the winner of Britt Baker, Ruby. No. She faces the winner of Nyla Rose, below Nightingale. Yes. I didn't even look at the chart. I had to remember, but I expect Athena to win. On the main card, this was just added last night on Rampage. Adam Cole taking on Filthy Tom Lawlor. And I like Tom Lawlor. He's a solid guy in New Japan, moving from MMA over to professional wrestling. He's done a very serviceable job. He looks good. But, I mean, Adam Cole's got to win, right? He's got to win. And this match isn't a part of the Owen Hart Cup. Adam Cole, remember, won last year. But Adam Cole versus Tom Lawlor should be a fun match. This shouldn't go long. I'm expecting 6 to 8 minutes because I know other matches are going to get a lot of time. But I take Adam Cole to win. Next up, we have Toni Storm defending the AEW Women's World Championship against Willow Nightingale. And this is low-key one of my favorite matches on the card. And this is one of the, I would probably say, two matches I am most looking forward to. I'm a fan of both of these women. Willow Nightingale has been on a little bit of a roll. She is the current New Japan Pro Wrestling Women Strong Women's Champion. I always get that mixed up. Hold on. She is the current Strong Women's Champion. Yes. And like I stated earlier, Toni Storm gets into these matches where her opponents are powerhouses and they have strength, so they're able to be a little bit more rough with her. Because Toni's a low-key small powerhouse herself, and Willow is a powerhouse. This is really, really going to be a fun match. I expect the crowd to be fully behind her and to really give us a strong match, no pun intended. But I expect Toni Storm to retain going into, I believe, our next event for AEW is All In. Let me make sure. I think All In's the next pay-per-view. Yeah, we have All In. And Tony's got to defend the championship, right? So this will be a fun match, a little bit of hard hitting match, and I'm expecting Willow to come off of a W in the Owen Hart. That's just me. Next up, we have a match that could potentially steal the show. Orange Cassidy defending the AEW International Championship against Zack Sabre Jr., the current IWGP World Television Champion, Dan Garcia, and Katsuyori Shibata, the current Ring of Honor Pure Champion. This will probably be the most technical match on the card. You know what I mean? Because you have Zack Sabre Jr., because you have Danny Garcia, because you have Shibata, you're going to get strikes, you're going to get holds, you're going to get chokes, and then you got Orange Cassidy, the fucking wild card. Now, we know what we're expecting the match of the night to be, or one of the matches of the night. This could, again, like last year in Orange Cassidy's matches, steal the show. Orange Cassidy's been on such a run that I don't see it ending here. Like, I thought it was going to end on Dynamite 2 weeks ago when he defended the championship against Swerve. I thought right there, I was like, this is a perfect time. Take the belt off of OC, put it on Swerve, elevate Swerve. Orange Cassidy can move on to something else while still now being fully elevated, being great. I don't expect him to lose here. I expect OC to retain here, probably with an orange punch, praying for Shibata, you know, that's my guy. And I really expect this match to do with set up Shibata and Daniel Garcia for the Pure Championship at the next Ring of Honor pay-per-view. But I like Orange Cassidy to retain here, and I wonder really what's next for him. Next up, we got CM Punk taking on Satoshi Kojima. This is another first round match in the Owen Hart Cup. And listen, Punk's not losing, but I like that they have a match on the card. So the winner of this match will take on the winner of Roderick Strong versus Samoa Joe. Roderick Strong has just like completely disappeared after defeating Chris Jericho. He's just not on TV right now. Like, I just really thought about that. But this will be a very, very solid match. Kojima's nobody to mess around, but listen, Punk's not going to be losing. He won't be losing any matches for a good long while. So expect him to move on to set up him versus Joe round 48, because these dudes will keep on fighting. Next up, Blackpool Combat Club of John Moxley, Claudio Castagnoli, and Wheeler Yuta teaming up with Shota Umino and Konosuke Takeshita to take on the Elite, Hangman Page, the Young Bucks, Eddie Kingston, and Tomohiro Ishii. Obviously, the standout, the wild card of this match, like one of these things are not like the other, is Eddie Kingston, because he doesn't really fit here in this feud, but he just got shoehorned in because he has history with everybody in here. He's friends with the BCC, obviously his best friends with John Moxley, but he's here because him and Claudio just have beef after beef and more beef. Takeshita is in his feud because of what happened, you know, how he turned on the Elite and turned on Kenny Omega, and Ishii is Eddie's boy, and they've gone to wars and they trust each other. Since Eddie doesn't trust the Elite, he can trust Ishii. I'm really surprised that this match doesn't have a stipulation on it. Like, this is not like a hardcore match or a street fight or no DQs or hell, or even Anarchy in the Arena. but this is going to be fun. This is going to be one of the longer matches on the card. I'm expecting 15 to 20 minutes here, maybe even a little bit longer, because it's Moxley, because it's Claudio, because it's the Young Bucks, because it's Hangman. They like to do longer matches, but take the BCC to win, seeing as how they did lose Anarchy in the Arena, right? They lost Anarchy in the Arena, right? Let me make sure. No, they won. They won. So take the Elite to win. I'm sorry. Take the Elite to win, since the BCC won Anarchy in the Arena, because this feud is far from over between these grouping of gentlemen, and I want to see where Eddie fits in after this, because you figure Claudio needs an opponent for, what's that, Death Before Dishonor, the next Ring of Honor pay-per-view. Eddie Kingston is right there for that rematch. Eddie is right there. Next up, we got the Suzuki guys, that's what we're calling them. Once again, teaming together, Chris Jericho, Sammy Guevara, and Minoru Suzuki. They will be taking on Sting, Darby Allin, and to be announced is not a person. They're just building hype for Collision for tonight. And Sting's going to announce who their third man is. Look, I love the team of Suzuki, Sammy, and Jericho. This is partly due to, you know, Jericho's going to be trying to keep Sammy in check, keeping him as a bad guy, but Sting is undefeated. Is Sting really gonna lose here? Like, wild. No, take Sting, Darby, and whoever the mystery opponent is to win. Who is the mystery opponent? I have no clue. You know, it's gonna be somebody from New Japan. Would it be Naito? Like, that's a reach, but it's got to be somebody wild. It's got to be somebody that the crowd would pop for. Watch it be fucking Goldberg. I swear to God if it's Goldberg. MJF will be defending the AEW World Championship against Hiroshi Tanahashi. So that is back-to-back Forbidden Doors, where Tanahashi is fighting for a World Championship. And listen, MJF is not losing. Yes, his championship run is, you know, running out of steam, but he's not losing. And I'm happy that we're getting to see him wrestle more. He gets to wrestle against the ace of New Japan. He's wrestling Tanahashi. Y'all don't. And it's like, it's such a far-fetched random match, but Tanahashi is that dude. So the question is, can MJF compete with Tanahashi? Can he go toe-to-toe with him in the ring when it comes to the wrestling ability? The answer is no. So now it's up to MJF to do what MJF does. You know what I mean? So he's going to retain, and I can see it possibly be doing, partly due to Adam Cole trying to help Tanahashi win and then it backfiring and MJF retained. So that's what I'm going to go with, MJF retaining the world championship. Another world championship match on the card, Sonata recently defeating Okada for the IWGP World Heavyweight Championship, will be defending his championship, the World Heavyweight Championship, against Jack Perry. And listen, I don't expect this to go long. 10 minutes, I'm expecting a heel turn. Because Jack Perry will have Hook with him. And we've seen Jack Perry against, you know, really top, top talent. Sonata is top, 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 top talent. You know what I mean? So will that aggressiveness that Jack Perry's been showing come out some more? Will he, you know, use some underhanded tactics? How will Hook play a part? But expect Sonata to retain, because he just won the championship, and then New Japan's not putting the championship on Jack Perry. Jack Perry's got obligations here. Next up, we have Kenny Omega defending the IWGP United States Heavyweight Championship in a rematch from Wrestle Kingdom against a longtime rival of his and Will Ospreay. And these two are going to murder, death, kill each other. They are. They just are. Their match at Wrestle Kingdom was amazing. It wasn't better than one of their other matches, but it was still an amazing match. And seeing how Kenny won before, I expect Ospreay to walk out of here the champion and go back to Japan. See, here's the thing. These two really, really know each other really, really well. So expect a lot of counters. Expect a lot of hard hitting strikes. I'm talking knees, chops, slaps, forearm smashes. It's going to be crazy, but Will Ospreay will be walking out the victor because Don Callis will cost Kenny Omega the match. Do not forget about that, y'all. Don Callis is that thing in the corner that you can't use. You see, but it's like, yo, is that somebody? Don Callis is going to cause Kenny Omega this match, so we can set up Omega versus Takeshita. All right? And in our main events, the dream match that's above dream matches, the match beyond matches, the match that we thought we'd never get to see. Bryan Danielson will take it on Kazuchika Okada. I don't know how else to sell this match. It is the myth of Okada versus the possibly greatest wrestler ever in Bryan Danielson. And I'm not being hyperbolic. The Rainmaker versus the American Dragon. Like I said earlier in the show, the floor of this match is 4.5 stars. The ceiling of this match is greatest match of all time. And yes, Danielson's a little banged up, but he also hasn't been wrestling. So I'm hoping he's healthy. We know Okada's healthy. But these two are going to go out of the way to give us something spectacular. Like, when we say this is a dream match beyond a dream match, I'm expecting people in the WWE to be watching this match. I'm expecting people in Impact Wrestling to watch this match. I'm ready to just sit down and enjoy this show. When it comes to the in-ring ability, like, these two are second to none, and they are going to put on a masterclass of storytelling, of holds, of strikes. I hope they just come out on the other side okay. Because knowing these two, they're going to want to steal the show. But Dan Sims is doing this thing where he's helping get other people over there. You don't need to get help with Okada or if it was Okada, but I'm expecting a loss there. I'm actually expecting Okada to win possibly by like 3 Rainmakers. I'm just ready, people. I am just ready. So, one more time, going over the results on the pre-show. Athena to defeat Billie Starkz. Adam Cole defeating Tom Lawlor. Toni Storm to retain against Willow Nightingale. Orange Cassidy to retain against Zack Sabre Jr., Daniel Garcia, and Katsuyori Shibata. CM Punk to defeat Satoshi Kojima, the Elite, Eddie Kingston, and Tomohiro Ishii to defeat the Blackpool Combat Club, Shoto Imano, and Konosuke Takeshita. Sting, Darby Allin, and their mystery partner to defeat Chris Jericho, Sam McVar, Minoru Suzuki, MJF to retain against Hiroshi Tanahashi. Sonata versus Jack Perry, with Sonata retaining the IWGP World Heavyweight Championship. And Will Ospreay to defeat Kenny Omega, winning the IWGP United States Heavyweight Championship. And Kazuchika Okada to defeat Brian Danielson. Back-to-back shows where Tanahashi's fighting for the same championship. But thank you all for listening. Hopefully, you enjoy the change in the format of the show. Don't forget to check out the High Risk Wrestling Recap every Sunday. First one going up tomorrow. Next week, I don't have anything on the schedule just yet, but we will have the schedule. We got coming up too? Besides the High Risk Wrestling Recap, we have our Money in the Bank preview. And we have What Just Happened, our recap show of Forbidden Door. Don't forget to check out the socials, Charismatic Creations on Facebook and YouTube, Charismatic underscore Creations 52 on Instagram, The 215 on Twitter, Ko-fi, Patreon, and as always, Shafty Blacker, Zaya Lee, Isla Dawn, Wendy Chu, Willow Nightingale, Bailey, and Gigi Dolan. Holla at your boy. Peace.